Hello, Malty, Martian Music Ministers, and thank you to Chris from Bremen, also known as Tunnel Amende. For Ralfy Review Malt Mention 827. Now, I highly recommend that you have probably about 827 whiskey and quality spirit experiences before you start spending too much money on old single malt and blended malt whiskies. They are a fantastic experience, but you're better not jumping in too early. Let your palate and let your sense of smell develop with the basic, accessible, standard whiskies before you tackle anything like this. Let me introduce Sirius 31-year-old blended malt. And I've bought this, and I'm reviewing it and recommending it to you because I think it's great stuff. Because one of the most affordable ways of experiencing a bottle of properly old malt whiskey, whether it be single or blended, it's from the independent bottlers, and particularly now when it's bottled as a blended malt, a mixture of two or more malt whiskies rather than a single malt, because single malts with age attract a big premium and they can be horrendously expensive. Seriously, there's some 30-year-old single malts out there. You're over £1,000 a bottle. And it's not just the official bottlers that have such high price tags on these whiskies, but even the independent bottlers do, particularly if it's a named single malt, like Lafroy or Ardbeg or Macallan. Age carries a premium, and as part of this review, I'm going to tell you why. But first of all, this, my merry maltster malt mates, was poured half an hour ago, and I added 1 milliliter of water to it. So very little water. Why? Because it's an old whiskey. This Sirius 31-year-old blended malt is bottled by North Star Spirits, one of the youngest and, in my opinion, one of the most interesting independent bottlers out there, because, well, this cost me about £140. I know, that's a lot of money, but this is good quality 31-year-old whiskey. Now, you're not going to get better value than that, to be honest. This is part of a small range within North Star Spirits, which includes Vega and Spica. There's been about 6 editions of Vega, everything from 22 up to 41-year-old whiskey, which went down an absolute storm when it appeared at Glasgow's Whiskey Festival and is very sought after for drinking rather than collecting, for drinking, for people who appreciate the taste of age and having the experience of that as part of their benchmark and their map bearings. So very popular in Scotland. Also, there's the Spica. I've got a bottle here, actually, which I bought a while ago. I've yet to open it because I can't open all the treasures at once. It's a 20-year-old, isn't it? Yeah, 20-year-old blended malt. And the Sirius. There we go. This is the kind of one of the latest bottlings. Natural colour, cask strength of 43.1%, so a relatively low cask strength. Now, I have a theory about that. Now, I'm not saying this is what they've done, but I have a theory about that, and I'll suggest it to you as an option. And distilled in 1988, so quite a while ago. What were you doing in 1988? In 1988, I started my new career as an undertaker at the cooperative in Glasgow. That was a long time ago, malt mates. 31 years. What we're paying for is the fact that someone has heated the stills, paid for the grain, made the spirit, They've put it into a cask which costs them money, and then they do nothing with it for over 30 years, during which time there are losses due to angel share and oxygenation, due to moving the cask, checking the cask, sampling the cask every 5 or even 10 years. And what happens is some of these old whiskies, they're on the books, but they're not in people's minds. And suddenly they discover through an inventory stock check that some of the old single malt they have has actually dropped below 40%, the legal minimum, so they can no longer sell it as whiskey. So they put it in the market and they sell it on, and the person that buys it say, right, I've got another good whiskey that's 31 or older, and I'm going to add it to GATT to make a blended malt, and I'll just balance it out so that we're definitely above 40%. It's a blended malt. But the most important thing is, malt mates, what really, really matters is, quite simply, how good were the casks? Because if you're going to spend 31 years in a cask, it better be a good one. Because if it's a bad one, the original contents are just going to get worse and worse and worse, not better and better and better. Bad casks always produce bad whiskey. So, I put a Pringle lid over this malt. I shall now give you a descriptor. I have to say, I think it's a natural colour. I'll just have a wee squint in the back label in case I missed something. Limited edition number one. Waxy and citrusy, blah, blah, blah. And then some information about the star Sirius, which I'll just give you one piece of information. It's 20 times more luminous, or shall we say brighter, 25 times brighter than the sun in our solar system. There you go. Now you've learned something about astronomy. You can't go wrong. Big, condensed, conserve like jam, fruit, an old-fashioned cough mixture. On first nosing this, I thought it was predominantly Glengarry. I still think it is predominantly one single malt, which has had a small proportion of another old single malt added to it to lift it above 40% to get a proper cask strength. And I think that, sure, they could have gone to 41%, 42, but at 43.1%, that's where the pitch became more perfect for the actual balancing of the blending of two, perhaps more than two single malts into this blended malt. It is voluminous on the nose, and you most certainly get the smell of age, but not just old age, not just mustiness and leather and tobacco and the usual cliches that are attached as descriptors to properly old whiskey. But there's something fresh and intact about this. And one of the first things you notice, particularly in the nose, and then you find it on the palate shortly thereafter, is that the cask in all these years hasn't swamped and dominated the event. So I'm not just getting the experience of an old cask calling all the shots, which can happen. This is much more balanced, much more subtle, but it's wonderfully intense with it. It really is, for the price, for the experience of the whiskey, at today's prices, in the scheme of things, and of course, malt mates, I'm talking about British Isles prices. I can't speak for the prices where you are, wherever you are in the world. It could be a lot more expensive. I don't know. I just don't know. But it is very good value for what you're paying for when you taste it. And I have already added water. However, if I'm to taste it neat, right? So I'll just give it a wee taste, absolutely neat. In fact, I've got a North Star glass here. I think I picked that one up at Glasgow Whisky Festival. Just a tiny wee drop to taste this neat. sharp, tannic, cough sweets, lozenges, medicinal, bright cinnamon notes, condensed conserve like cherry jam, red cherry jam. It's quite bright. There's an alcoholic nip towards the finish. Having rested it for 30 minutes with a little drop of water, always add smaller amounts to older whiskey. You can always add more. You can never take the water back out once you've added it. And if you drown your whiskey with too much water, don't think you can add more whiskey and it'll undrown it. Doesn't work that way, malt mates. Just sharing. Bear with me. I need to focus and concentrate in this. The nose is more lemony, more pineapple, soft pineapple, gingery, cinnamon again, softer, much more elegant, floral notes. It's gone from being uptight at the relatively low cask strength. It's that fragility. It's more relaxed now. It's expressing itself. It's chilling out. It's no longer an awkward acquaintance. A little drop of water, just, it's like a 50-year-old Armagnac. It's got that quality to it. Armagnac, very underrated French spirit. Taste, bear with me. Huge arrival. Intense, but subtle at the same time. Slightly waxy. Cedar wood. Raisin, intense raisin. Pineapple. Conserve, it's that jam notes again. Everything fruity in here is expressing itself as the jam or conserve version. Backdrop of vanilla and muscovado develops a little bit more spicy. The cinnamon comes through, hint of clove in the background, touch of dryness, savoury dryness coming in the casks, which is coming across as turmeric. Dry spice, no. Exquisite in the halfway through the long but subtle development, you get this wonderful camphorish tannic note which sustains right into the finish. It's crisp as a wafer. It is lemon fresh in the finish. It is so clean and delightful. It's a fantastic finish. This can go toe to toe with any single malt, which would probably be at least five times the price. That's why I'm reviewing this. That's why I'm mentioning it to you, so that you know what are the malts involved in this. I haven't asked, I haven't checked. Frankly, I don't particularly care. But I tell you what, forget the malts, the casks. At 30, over 30 years, it's the casks we're bothered about. And these casks are magnificent, old school casks, which on emptying, you would reuse as quickly as possible because they'll have that present. Bear in mind, the cask used for this was used, probably a refill cask, by the way, not a first fill cask, refill cask, 1988. This was filled with what the spirits that was being matured in at the casks. And before that, they may have had 10 years, 15 years with other spirit, other whiskey in them. We don't quite know, but we know that timeline is there, which would take us back to the 1970s. So it's this awareness. And once you have experience under your belt, once you've spent about 4 or 5 years exploring the range of quality spirits, then you turn your attention to these type of bottlings. And I can assure you that all the malt fans out there that have a sip of this are not disappointed. What am I going to give this? Got to give a malt mark. It's 90 out of 100. Blended malt. It would have been nice if it had said natural colour in the bottle. I'm going to have another look just to check in case I've missed it. Blended malt, scotch, cask strength, non-chill filtered. No, doesn't say. I must have a word with them. Malt mates, oh, we've enjoyed this. If you pop back shortly for my extras, 827 extras, I'm going to be continuing with talking about an old blended Scotch whiskey. It could be an old single malt, an old blended, what to do and how to treat it when you first buy it. Okay, I hope you'll join me because I have tons of experience to share, which I've picked up over the decades. And it'll all be good quality, useful content, which will up malt mate your malt matiness. Just saying. Thank you for watching. Hope you've enjoyed this. See you soon.